Pretty targeted bands coming out here. Meteos doing too good on the lease-in, says Curse. So we're going to take that away. Sivir, been seeing a lot of picks. Not too many bands lately, but now she is.
It's a bit of an interesting Sivir band. Of course, Sneaky was 2-0 on Sivir. Yeah. And Cloud9 has struggled against Sivir so far this split. I think it's an interesting band for Curse because Cloud9 would rely on that movement speed so much. When Cloud9 is at their best, it's because they can force multiple fights on the map and generally have more people in an area.
Right.
And Sivir is a key component for that in the mid game. So getting that out of their hands is pretty beneficial.
I like like Saint said, Lemon Nation roaming around with the team, getting things up and ready with map pressure, and then they take control of the game. Waiting for the first pick for Quas. Looks like he's actually taking something from
like
the team here.
Resh as well. Just
it is open. Yep.
Nothing huge is up. It's Elise is obviously there. They might want to deny that from Meteos and let I Will Dominate play it. But interestingly enough, I Will Dominate hasn't played it, and yeah, we forgot about that one.
Yeah, Void Boy actually has not played it. So this is going to be his first time coming in onto LeBlanc. But we also have seen LeBlanc in the top lane. And Quaz is one of those that has a giant champion pool for top lane as well.
Yeah.
So can't put that anywhere yet.
And you can see that big 100% champion win rate for the LeBlanc.
Yeah.
We'll see if that 11-0 in the North American LCS streak can continue with either Void Boy or Quaz taking the helm on that. And then the two picks that we were considering Curse would take obviously go over to Cloud9 because those are high on their priority list.
Easy grabs there. They don't have to worry about too much of that part of the early game. Meteos is one of his highest picks is Elise, so he's happy to be on that. And now it's up for Void Boy to pick it up for Saint Vicious. Saint Vicious has tried a bit on Leona. He's 1-1 with that. Looks like they're going to lock it in again.
Yeah, those are the supports that people have been playing. Not too much to say about that one. Hard initiation on both sides. The Leona really fits St. Vicious's playstyle. Being able to go in with Vi and LeBlanc means whatever backline Cloud9 wants to pick, they're going to need a lot of elusiveness or a lot of safety.
Right.
Just a bit of tankiness, you know?
I'm going to point out that Curse formulating a pick comp here, trying to get that kill potential up through the roof so far with the picks they have. Like you said, Cloud9 looking for safety here, but also something they can control the game with. Hi has quite a bit to choose from.
I wouldn't be too surprised if they pick something like Caitlyn as their AD carry just because they can keep so much distance with it. And maybe a big tank up top for Balls. Oh, no. Well, they haven't picked Balls pick yet. They did go for the Caitlyn.
That's been since week one
since
Hi got his hands on Diaso. I think it's been since week one since anyone has gotten their hands on Diaso.
Yeah, and something that we have to point out is we are on the 4.1 patch, by the way. So that is before the majority of the Yasuo nerfs have hit. He is still still quite strong right now. And currently the only knock-up synergy they have is with Thresh. It'll be interesting to see if they try and put a Shyvana in the top lane just for a little bit of added synergy.
And Void Boy will know how to play against that. He himself has two games on Yasuo. Actually, in week four that was played, so 2 weeks ago, so not too long. We see the picks coming out. I think they're kind of taking that away from our Balls here. So a nice pickup on the Rumble as well as it being good for Quas.
Yeah, 5 Renekton picks, 4 Balls, 0 Renekton picks so far from Quas. But Renekton in the past has been one of his favorite champions to play. He is very capable of that. And yeah, of course, the Shyvana on the other side. They're going to try and synergize that with the Yasuo knockups. And pretty solid team comps for both sides here.
And no Lemon Nation for his Flash Blaze. He'll be in there for high as well on Yasuo. We'll see what they can get going for this. You see Lemon giving the last few tidbits of info before they head into the load.
Yeah, there will be some very interesting team fights in this game, I think, just because there's so much pick potential on the side of Curse with just the the bottom lane. Leona, Ezreal have the capability of completely bursting out someone if they just land Leona ult, and then Ezreal can throw his combo. LeBlanc, just because she is LeBlanc, can do that. And then you look on the other side, very team fight oriented. If they could pull off some type of combo where Shyvana gets a displacement on multiple people and then Hai can combo with the Yasuo ult, the fight would basically be over right there. So Curse definitely needs to look for a bit more of the smaller engagements, picking people off, playing with the fog of war, whereas Cloud9 is trying to find those big brawly fights.
All right, we'll see as the teams load under the rift. Let's see who you think will come out on top. According to LOLesports.com, 78% of you think that Cloud9 is going to take this win, which is actually pretty low. I feel for Cloud9, I mean, considering Coast, last split. And
if
what
Coast was the 6%, TSM was 94.
Yeah.
It makes a little bit of sense, though. Curse has been trending very heavily upwards, and Cloud9 has looked a little vulnerable for the first time since they really joined the North American LCS.
So playing, look at the Yasuo pick for a second. We haven't seen him in a few weeks. Knowing that there's a Yasuo in the game, the potential for any one of your champions to pretty much be zeroed out, how do you consider the early game? How do you play into that, knowing that at any time the other team's about to explode with damage?
Yeah, it'll be a very interesting laning phase, I think, because whichever person gets ahead, whether it's LeBlanc or Yasuo, will have a huge amount of swing on the other lanes, and it's a very skill-intensive matchup in the mid lane. I've seen this exact matchup twice in the LCS, and it's gone completely opposite ways. It really depends on how good Hai is with his wind wall to block Void Boy's burst.
Another awesome thing to check out as we go into our third game of the day. We've had some amazing games so far with TSM's win streak being snapped. We'll see what Curse can do to get some wins under their belt, as well as Cloud9. Curse is 5-7 on the split. Cloud9 is 9-3. And Cloud9 has the head-to-head matchup versus Curse. So we'll see if Curse can even that up, too.
Hey, and especially with Coast and Evil Geniuses winning already today, this is becoming more of a must-win for Curse. Curse isn't really considered as one of those bottom-of-the-LCS teams, but it is a real possibility if they don't start winning this game that they'd be down in those bottom two spots.
We'll see what they have for each other coming in. Curse has a pretty hard week, I believe, Dignitas tomorrow and Cloud9 today. So if they can get this win, it's going to be very, very helpful for them. Definitely in the mentality and the momentum department. Sneaky in mid lane. I was looking, where's Sneaky? Sneaky's in mid lane, as always. Yeah.
Definitely seeing a little bit more early action today, though.
Yeah, we are. That's been
really
great.
There hasn't been much in the first 5 weeks of the North American LCS, but first game, Evil Geniuses with fantastic tactics, level one, trying to sneak in a side brush, and then the delayed invade in that TSM versus Coast game. Knowing that one of these teams has Thresh on their side, a delayed invade would be a possibility, but it's much harder to do that from the side of the map they're on right now because the access to bottom lane is a little bit more difficult, but there they go.
We're going to get the action right here as they hatch that ward just above the red pit. But they do get one down. They're going to have a bit of control, at least for the vision and timing, keep themselves safe. Looks like they're going to stay, though.
Yeah, a choice to not contest because they saw everyone walk in. They haven't necessarily seen them walk out, so Cloud9 could pull a feint here and get back to their red, but it looks like they're just going to trade buffs. So a very Season 3-esque start with a spotted invade via a ward and then just a straight-up red buff trade.
This kind of plays into how Cloud9 usually plays their bottom lane with not a lot of wards. This is the first time we really see a team using the wards for invade. Usually you see Curse, their regular setup of wards, to know where the jungler's going and how it's working.
Yeah, well, the interesting thing about this is Cloud9 doesn't need wards in the bottom lane because they force the enemy jungler to the opposite red. There is no way I Will Dominate could start any farther away from the bottom lane than what they forced him into doing there. So the gank threat isn't actually real at the moment, and they're safe to play with that wards.
Great job by Cloud9 so far. Void Boy, even taking damage when he tries to trade there, you saw in his distortion. So he's got to be careful in that lane. Hai's trying to take the aggression immediately.
Yasuo's level 1 and 2 are obscenely strong because the E with that additive damage, 25% the more he dashes through, really, really hurts early on in the game, more so than almost anyone else. Not to mention he has that shield up right now. It's around level 5 and 6, maybe to about level 9 or 10 before he gets his items going, that Void Boy would look to take advantage.
Knowing that it's just a few items to get Hai going, I'm sure he'll be shooting for that immediately in that mid lane. Already level 3 over Void Boy, and just by a minion you can see, so they're keeping it pretty even in that lane. Dominate not slowed down too much in the jungle just yet, but we really haven't seen the result of having to go and get the topside red buff.
Yeah, well, we'll see if he can pull off the gank here. If Hai uses the dash in at the wrong time, he has no jungle support from Meteos at the moment. Meteos trying to support balls a little bit up top.
Yeah, gotta expect that. Renekton, he's gonna be that grizzly croc in the early part of the game, putting down the damage, but it looks like they are gonna put down the pressure onto him. They give the Volatile Spider a little bit of time. And actually, Meteos is given some, I believe, respect to Dominate because he's around, maybe?
Well, they just had to be very careful ganking Renekton. He is the guy who turns around ganks on junglers more so than almost any other laner. Nice hook in the bottom.
A good hook Peacemaker for a trade.
Yeah, just to get back to that, that top lane matchup a little bit. At the moment, Balls just wants to stay even and not die before he can start taking over. Medios came up there to give him a bit of breathing room and make sure he could last hit at his turret. And just because of the way the counter jungling went, oftentimes when teams do invades and have to start at each other's buffs, it does decelerate the ganking paths of these guys. So he wasn't necessarily worried that I Will Dominate was ganking somewhere else, and the investment was literally just to give Balls some breathing room in CS, which he did successfully.
We always talk about how Renekton pushes his opponent to the turret, so great moves by Medios, helping Balls in the top lane. We know Balls can get behind quite far in that lane and still be very useful to the team come late game. He just has that mentality to keep himself alive and running. 400 gold lead for Cloud9 here, as they are keeping themselves well CS'd in the lanes. You can see High with the pressure on a Void Boy. LeBlanc's not the best last hitter at the turret.
Not super early on in the game. She is vulnerable to getting shoved in a little bit. We'll see if Void Boy goes for a wave clear build fairly shortly, whether he gets a huge amount of blue buffs or whether he prioritizes some mana regeneration so he can spam his distortion on the wave is yet to be seen. But as far as just the overall laning picture goes, it's even, aside from the bottom lane, with that Caitlyn and Thresh pick. Doing pretty good work for Cloud9.
Sneaky. He's pretty good at farming. Very good at getting the damage in as well to keep them ahead in the bottom lane. We really see Lemonation and Sneaky going behind when they're consistently ganked in lane. They usually don't lose it on their own accord.
Which does happen fairly frequently, to be fair. Teams love to try and pick Sneaky and Lemonation off. Sneaky has a very interesting play style where a lot of teams don't like to give him credit, but his score near the end of the game is often really strong. He will always just maximize damage in teamfights, no matter what, which does mean that sometimes he'll get caught out or look like he is out of position, but oftentimes Cloud9 will win a teamfight after something like that happens.
So the consistency on the ward for the red buff, they got about another minute for that, but they're actually going to try to push Void Boy possibly off of this mid lane to make it safer.
Yeah, this would be a very interesting invade by them. The timers on the red buff are completely desynced.
Yeah.
Because early on in the game, I Will Dominate left the small monsters at the red buff, whereas Medios cleared them out. So if they wanted to invade and they were successful with it, they would potentially get both of the red buffs, which means it would be a higher reward invade by them because they wouldn't just trade them. However, it is very dangerous to do that at this point in the game.
Dominate's already on that portion of the jungle. It looks like he'll be able to get his red without the harassment of Medios, as we still watch High and Void Boy here in the mid lane. Both share around a 2.5 KDA. That's because we said they go aggressive and they go in on the fights. High looking to get some damage done.
That could have just been for the harass as well, because we see Cloud9 has three wards in the jungle of Curse right now, and they're all moving for that invade. It's working across the map. Sneaky and Lemonation are winning the lane and have them pushed back. Therefore, it enables them to walk in for this invade.
And this is when you know you have the control, when the opponents can visibly see you moving and they really can't do anything about it.
Yeah. It was just High getting enough damage down and bottom lane having enough control that enabled Medios to do this. You look at the scoreboard, you say, wow, Medios, great counter jungling, but without the lanes both winning on their own ground, that invade would not have been possible.
Medios is the man who stated, put on Reddit and social media, that if your lanes are winning, go gank the other jungler. Give him a hard time. And right there, they're not letting Dominate get off easy. 8 minutes into this one, he is going to try to do some useful things, though, for himself. The top part of that mid is warded, so High is going to be safe, just kind of hurtfully using his time up.
This is the point in the game, though, where teams would want to gank Yasuo quite a lot. Luckily for High, he has a ward in just the right place and a jungler on the other side, so he is protected in both ways. Also, because I Will Dominate's jungle has been invaded so heavily, he hasn't wandered into that river, which means that pink ward is up for quite some time and protecting both sides for him.
This is going to be a good game for Medios as well. He gets to soak up all the blue buffs for himself. See if that puts him over Dominate, as they'll be giving those over to Void Boy. Dragon's going to be theirs, coming in 8.5 minutes into the game. A very Cloud9-esque game, if you will. They're just controlling everything.
Really a smooth rotation there by Cloud9, a no-risk Dragon. High recognized when Void Boy peeled away for the blue buff, meaning that even if the bottom lane was there to contest, they would have no LeBlanc.
Yeah.
Therefore, it was a very safe Dragon take, and Cloud9 gets it uncontested.
Curse not with the ultimate Dragon fighting team either at this point. Not getting too much damage out of Cop or Void Boy. We'll see if they can get it in a few more minutes. They got to wait a little bit. Void Boy is in the mid lane. He's doing fine. 73 to 66. Picking up a ring so he doesn't just get burst out of lane by the damage of High here on constant attacks.
Yeah, Void's going to want to start roaming fairly shortly. We talked earlier how Cloud9 is the team that wants to get the big team fights with Shyvana and the Yasuo combo. And Voi Voi and the rest of Curse are the teams that want to roam around and get the odd number of fights, use LeBlanc first.
Oh.
And the start of that roam is Voi Voi going down there and clearing out that pink ward. Now he's going to be more free to walk down that river if he can shove high out of lane.
Great little wind wall there, saving high for some damage. And we can see now that Balls is level 8, Renekton's kind of lost that early game pressure for himself. But also building the Tiamat to keep the lane pushed against Balls. Isn't really giving him the armor he needs.
Yeah, all power to Balls right there. Doing great to just stay completely even with Quas. Oftentimes at this point in the game, you would have seen the Renekton in between the Shyvana's turrets maybe a couple times. That has just not been the case. A little bit of it has to be that Meteos has spent a fair amount of time just being near Quas, which scares him off of going aggressive. And now Balls knows what to do with it.
This is Quas's first Renekton game. May not see him going full force and going for broke on some of these fights. So he's going to play it pretty consistent, like you said, along with Balls. Now bottom lane, we see St. Vicious gaining a little bit of brush control here. They haven't really tried to activate too much in the bottom lane, just playing it safe.
No, and unlike the first two games today, we might see a bottom lane gank. We've seen a lot of solo lane focus thus far, but Vi, if she excels at anything, it's ganking for that bottom lane. All it would take is one good St. Vicious stun, and everything would come in afterwards. There's a lot of zone control coming out from Cloud9, though, with the Thresh and the traps from Caitlyn, making this gank a difficulty.
Oh, there's a hit. A very nice box to come down. The Solar Flare hits Saint on his own head, and it doesn't do much.
Yeah, he tried to point blank the ult because he was trying to chain his stuns together. But there was a net out right before that. Saint burns everything. Sneaky loses just a bit of health.
Night nice off damage. Coming from Voi Voi. Yeah, very nice damage. Voi Voi feeling confident about his lane now, and I would not get in range of a distortion QR right now from Voi Voi. That needlessly large rod was a fast buy to give back the same amount of damage that he's been receiving. That is quite deep from Dominate, who's been having a little bit of trouble this game.
That
wasn't tanky enough.
Way too far. A big miscommunication there. Voi Voi had used his ultimate previously, so he could not double distortion in to go support that I will Dominate gank. He ends up running his flash and his ultimate just for the flash of high, and takes a bunch of damage and loses control of the mid lane. Ill-advised move there by Curse.
Quas trying to take an advantage when he can. Looks like Balls pushed up a little too far and has been taking damage, so he will back in the top lane. We just say that Ignite is down in the flash for Voi Voi as well, just recently cut down with that last engagement.
Right, now that we've seen the first turret go down, we're going to be entering a little bit more of a roaming phase. There's not as much safety on the map, especially for the LeBlanc roam. Therefore, if we look at some of the builds of Cloud9, we can see they're going a little bit more for tankiness or just resilience right now. Meteos has went directly for the tank spirit. A lot of times, Elise's will stop at a spirit stone or even just the Hunter's Machete and go for the full magic penetration.
But
against the LeBlanc, that's just suicide, and Voibu would kill him. Likewise, Sunfire Cape up top. Caitlyn is mobile in her own right, and Thresh has a Dorn shield early on. So if Voi Voi wants to take someone out, he's got to go very deep, and he won't necessarily be able to take out the main threats at this point in the game, which are the two solo laners and the jungle.
Well, those main threats are going to be very well off in the extended fight, and that's going to be bad for Voi Voi. Hopefully he continues to get his blue buff and keeps himself on the top of the game. Right now he's level 9. It looks like everybody's kind of averaging out around there. So good things for Cloud9 and Curse. No kills on the map so far. We're 13 minutes in. I think our longest first blood for today.
Yeah, definitely for today. And start keeping the timer on longest first blood of the year. I believe that was somewhere in the 20-minute mark.
Yep.
There's actually a game in 2013 season that didn't have first blood until 25 minutes.
Good
but I don't think we're on the pace for that one. I think the next dragon fight could be a big point of contention.
Which has already gone in favor of Cloud9, that first dragon, quick.
And the way Cloud9 is continually coming in to try and invade the jungle of Curse against someone as threatening as LeBlanc is really just asking for battle. Curse is not going to take too kindly to getting invaded like that. And Cloud9 is not a team to really let up on stuff like that either.
We'll still have to see how that coordination between Balls and High go with displacing somebody in the Yasuo's Last Breath. If they can get those alts in, or else it's just up to High for those initiations. 14 minutes in, both teams giving each other a little bit of space here as they go for their buffs.
Yeah, and this is actually a more contestable dragon for Curse, as long as they realize when Cloud9 took the last one. The window for Cloud9 to take their last dragon was because Boy Boy peeled off to take the blue buff. Dragon respawns every 6 minutes. Blue buff respawns every 5.
Right.
So on this rotation of the timers, it means that they can take the blue buff and then make it for the dragon fight, just based on the timers that Cloud9 worked with last time.
And this blue buff was not something Meteos goes over to aggress on. He was back in base, making sure he gets that buy of the Sorc boots since he rushed the golem, and he'll be back down ready for dragon here. Boy Boy may try to get some damage onto high here. Knowing the dragon's coming up, I feel those two could engage quite soon.
Yeah, so Meteos has a lot of good items.
Yeah.
High doesn't really. Just the Zeal. You definitely want the Static Shiv, maybe even some attack damage on Yasuo before he becomes potent in those situations. However, there is pink ward control from Cloud9. A lot of roaming coming down as well. Let's see if they can take this dragon while High distracts in mid.
You get the flow down. He'll have that charge coming up from his ultimate, but it looks like it's just a 1-2 punch there for Curse to get into position. Cloud9's already done it under their nose, though.
Yeah, they had a ward over the top of it, but you could definitely tell Curse was slow on the uptake from that, which is a little surprising, considering obviously they didn't have an exact timer on the dragon.
Right.
But it would have been a good thing to try and contest, knowing Boy Boy can maybe blow someone up since they haven't been able to itemize too much tankiness. A good take by Cloud9, but I think a missed opportunity for at least looking for a catch on Curse's side.
At least taking that chance,
trying
to turn it into something. Well, with that, a little bit of a gold lead here for C9. The dragons are going to be very helpful as those two and the timer are in their favor. We'll see. Sneaky now. Bloodthirster finished up, but that's going to be comparable to Cops. They're keeping it pretty even in the bottom lane, 150 to 139 there.
Aside from getting pushed in for a really long time, which has cost them other objectives, Cop and St. Vicious are standing pat. It's an interesting bot lane here for Curse, because obviously Cop played the first half of the season with Zekan, and very recently has had to lane with St. Vicious. Curse has St. Vicious on support more for his mid-game and shot-calling actions than for his actual laning skill. And I would say they definitely lost that lane, even if the CS stays fairly close, and it's to Cop's credit that he's been able to keep up that farm, because I feel like St. Vicious has had very little to no presence in that lane,
right,
based on how they've been pushed in that entire early game.
Well, St., we have to remember when he played Alistar, made an impact when the lanes were winning, because he could roam mid lane and help. Those shot calls from him were really, really big. But right now, like you said, when he can't make them, they're forced to fall behind on their heels. They lose mid-turret here at 16.
And the flash down on St. Vicious means the initiation potential from Curse is greatly diminished. Curse has had some troubles this year when they fall a little bit behind in the game, finding the right thing to do. It seems like Curse's games are either absolute bloodbaths or just that 4-0 loss like they had earlier to COG, where they just do nothing and get all their turrets pushed in. They have to find some type of middle ground. Right now, it's looking like one of those games where Cloud9 is just out-rotating and Curse is gun-shy about going in for some fights, because there's been a couple opportunities where they could have tried to force some action, and they've decided against it, therefore forfeiting some advantage
to
Cloud9.
It's like they're really relying on the combination of their ultimates to have to happen. They're not taking any chances where they wouldn't get the full effect out of it. We'll see, as it is about 26,000 to 23. That's a small gold lead, but it is going to start meeting. Core items are being finished. Like you said, that static shiv is going to be big for High, but he also has to watch out that Boy Boy has completed his Deathfire Grasp.
Yeah, and big gold totals on those top laners as well. Ball sitting on 2300 versus 1800. First action from Curse, going for balls.
He's going to be quite in a bad spot. Brings the Assault and Battery back with the Dragon's Descent, but it's going to be good damage. First blood at 18 minutes into the game for Curse.
Yeah, but what does this cost them? They move their jungler and their mid laner up top. There's a lot of pressure on the rest of the lanes. Cloud9's going to try and make something happen off this one.
This is already a lane. They've taken down that first tier turret. High is going to go back, try to bait Cop and do a little bit of damage. Oh, the play is the activation. That's the one they got in. The box damage just sitting on the outside, and a great turret tank by Lemon Nation.
There's that Thresh versus Yasuo synergy, trying to get a combo so High can knock him up more readily. If they get a turret and a kill off of this, it is their benefit.
Bing, bang, boom. That's the LeBlanc, the magician, trying to get out. The clone goes one. High goes the other way. He's got his X-Specs on. He knows which one to go for.
How many people are going to take on one after the other? Here comes Saint.
Uh-oh. Saint going in. 2v1 situation. Nobody else is there. It's Dominate flashes for the Q, but he's just short on the end. High's trying to dip, dodge, and dash, but they got wrenches.
Yeah, the reign of High's Yasuo ends there. But not after they deal a bunch of damage to Curse's entire structure base. Let's take another look at this. this combo. It's just Lemonation getting the play directly into high coming in. And the great thing is he was knocked up as the box was populating around him. Mm-hmm. So he got really messed up in that whole combo. And then, of course, Void Boy gets in for a clean assassination. But, of course, it's all about Cloud9 rotating down a little bit sooner there. Because there was such an investment by Curse in the top lane, Cloud9 found some good pressure on the other side. And yes, finally, Curse. After Curse stands down, all the people that were actually top lane, they finish off.
Sneaky says, see you later. You can go down in 2-0-1. That's fine for him. He's already getting to build his damage. A BF sword comes out of that little excursion in the bottom lane for high. He's going to be very scary soon. This is what I was asking Jad about before, when high is just going to explode. We're getting to that point. 20 minutes into the game, 1 minute and 15 for the Dragon. His balls finds a little bit of aggression in the top lane after just getting back to lane from dying.
Yeah, it's the roam coming in from Boibo right now, and he's actually trying to get Quas's Renekton going. Mm-hmm. As opposed to the bottom lane, it's because St. Fishes is very much also a roamer right here, and it seems like they're trying to get control of the top side of the map first and foremost.
They have it. If they have top side, they have the blue buff control. They can kind of shut down Void Boy a little bit more, but he's been getting that for himself pretty consistently here so he can keep himself in a position to just kill, kill, kill. Right now, 1-1-1, he cannot be the LeBlanc he wants to be.
Curse has all their ultimates up right now and 5 in the mid lane. There is down a Shyvana ult, I believe, unless it's back up again. There's a hook. Let's see if we see a fight.
They didn't have the eyes on Void Boy. It's going to be Quas in the top, and they want high so bad right now. It's going to be him. Oh, going down real fast. It's 30 seconds on the clock. This fight could be extended out by Curse, but they know Dragon's up, and they're going to wait it out.
Really good timer right there by Curse. It seems like Cloud9's going to try and counter push the mid lane a little bit. The timer is not exact on the Dragon, and they have to deal with that middle lane.
Yeah, they do.
Maybe after getting that kill, Curse puts themselves out of position by having a bad timer.
Very good call here. Lemonation throws down the shield so they can get there quicker, and it looks like with that, they are going to stay for Dragon. Good call from Curse.
Kind of make the best of a bad situation
absolutely.
There. Definitely should have saved some base defenders after that fight. In the engagement itself, High was caught off around the side. He definitely was trying to flank on Yasuo, and that was the pick potential of Curse. They're going to be wanting to do more of that in these upcoming fights. Instead of fighting Cloud9 head-on, catching the people trying to flank them gives Curse the edge.
I like this too. They got Dragon, or they didn't get Dragon. They got mid lane. They know Dragon went down, and they say mid's not enough. We got to get top lane now, too. It's open. It's too easy for us to get, and they need to open this up now.
Yeah, turret rotations by Cloud9 have been far superior in this game to Curse. They have slightly better lane pushing with the Static Shiv and the Shyvana with the Sunfire Cape, plus the Caitlyn, so the lane pressure has accumulated throughout the game. But even so, it being a 5-turret-to-1 advantage is a bit much. It means Cloud9 has substantially outplayed them in the pushing stage.
Just trying to see how much sweeping has been done over these wards. Not too many. High has 2 swept out, so they're really just keeping themselves focused on the push right now. They haven't had actually too much time to ward or sweep wards going into these fights. 4-2, Curse has more kills somehow coming into this game, but it's really because they've gotten the focus on the fights, just nothing to push after, and that's really what they need. They need to get this gold that's just sitting on the map in front of them.
Well, it's kind of this return to mid lane right now. Curse is in a sticky situation because since they're down 5 turrets, if they stay back and sit by their turrets, Cloud9 will accumulate a lead, they will steal Curse's jungle, and they will pressure around the Baron buff. So Curse is trying to put a strong front on in the mid lane as long as they can stop split pushing and then find fights there. Because if they don't find fights now, they will get bled out by Cloud9 and eventually just fall back. This is Curse trying to find that initiative. They do not want to sit back and get starved out by Cloud9, but it puts them in a dangerous situation.
Talisman for talisman, eye for an eye, as they go in the initiation on a fight. You can see Cloud9 just previously putting down a pink ward, shutting down the fog of war that Void Boy or any of Curse can use to get the pick out. They go right onto High. Nice true shot barrage through the middle of the fight. High can't get out just yet. Dominate takes him down. Ball's trying to get to the back line. They take out Void Boy, so the high front end damage is taken out from both sides. Dominate back onto Sneaky. Can he keep peeling? Caitlyn, one of his best champions, keeps himself alive with the help of the rest of Cloud9. Ace in the hole from the backside takes out Quas. They are on to Cop, but he's got the blue buff and he stays safe.
Yeah, everyone piled onto High, but at what cost there for a Curse? They wanted the fight, they needed the fight, and they got completely destroyed in the fight. Looks like Cloud9 can take this Baron right afterwards.
Playing it very safe, just calm, cool, and collected throughout the fight.
Big problem here is when Boy got blown up at the start of that. You could see Meteos and Balls finished him off. Therefore, there wasn't strong enough dive onto Sneaky. And this is what I talk about. Cloud9 peels for Sneaky so well when there were Saint Fishes and Dominant on him. The entire team pushed back and saved Sneaky. Then he could support from the back. That was really what secured him the fight. Boy Boy getting caught very early on, and then Sneaky being protected by the entire crew of Cloud9.
Such great peel coming in too. Not like you get a lot of crowd control from a Shyvana and whatnot. You're just running next to him, doing as much damage and trying to deter the fight. But
oftentimes that's enough.
Yeah, together they're able to make it happen. 2-0-3 for Sneaky. Like I said, 3-0 so far on Caitlyn. He could make it 4-0 with this game as Cloud9 has a pretty good lead. 6,000 gold in their favor at 25 minutes in. The kills are quite even because we've said Curse and Cloud9, both fighting teams. They go really hard.
And especially after that last fight, I wonder how much Curse is going to be able to do in this game.
Yeah.
They found what was a pretty good initiation by taking down High before he could end any of his damage in that fight. And Yasuo pretty much just brings damage. So taking him out early and then still losing the fight 4-1 is a big demoralizing factor and tells Curse they can't fight even manned anymore. They need to have a man or two advantage. And I think Cloud9's a good enough team, especially with the split-pushing presence that High is going to bring now, that might be impossible for them to find.
It's going to be very strong. Right now, Cloud9's a little grouped up in the bot lane, using this Baron to their advantage. They are causing Curse to move all around the map. They are formulating every strategy that Curse could be doing right now, and it looks like they're ready to stop it.
Yeah, Curse was hoping they'd get a sloppy rotation on the Cloud9, but Cloud9 comes straight through the lane, playing it safe, and obviously, Curse just has to fall straight back to the base. Because Cloud9 is too strong right now.
The Baron's too big. They're coming in with waves. They don't have anything top and mid, so this actually gives Curse something they may be able to siege back on here if Cloud9 makes a wrong move. They have the idea. They may have the power. It's all up to Void Boy and Dominate to make a good pick here. Sneaky's going to keep himself in a safe spot and already laying down traps to make it harder for Curse.
Yeah, I feel like at this point, Curse would have to find a counter engage on the turret if Cloud9 dives too hard. But with that wind wall, with the Caitlyn to safely siege these turrets, I don't feel like Cloud9's going to be overcommitting anytime soon.
Pretty good clear out. Really just flexing their muscles at this turret. Cloud9 is a team that we know to play very, very patient, not make a mistake. They have 30 seconds on the dragon. If they don't get anything here, they're more than happy to take that. Baron's already on them, so this gold lead is only getting bigger and bigger. They're not really wasting time right now. They're really just
Boy Boy down pretty well.
Bleeding Curse out.
They're just going to be hitting. Surprised Sneaky's not going more aggressive on this turret, seeing as they do have a Thresh to try and clean him out. I think they're worried because Sneaky has not itemized magic resistance yet, and the LeBlanc would be the one thing that could turn this fight if LeBlanc could get a full combo on a Sneaky. So it is holding off the push for a little while. Maybe Cloud9 should try a split push.
So it makes it so scary, having that ability to blow someone up. But like you said, Void Boy also respecting the fact that Cloud9 is just going to close in on that engagement.
Well, they have a Baron buff for a very short time later. They might go in on this exact push.
The hook to Dominate, not enough of what they wanted. No. They're just trading damage to everybody that's slowly being healed up. Dragon is going to come back up, and they say, all right, we'll peel off for now.
Yeah, if they weren't going in on that push, they're not going in at all because there's too many other objectives for them to take. Like the Dragon.
That kind of spells good things for Curse. It's not great, but at least they can hold off that first push, especially with the Baron.
Yeah. Not even the best wave clear on their team either, so it does show that they can do a fairly good hold. Kopp was able to finish his Trinity Force as well, which is very important, because he was about an item and a half back on Sneaky.
Yeah,
he's just one item back. It's a little bit more respectable as far as being able to stand toe-to-toe in a team fight, but this gold lead is just accumulating higher and higher. You add that to the fact that Cloud9's team fight, just going to say that actually, what the Twitter guy said, their team fight is much stronger. And that's one of the reasons that Cloud9 has so much control right here.
Well, they knew they could take that first dragon. It was easy. They had no contest coming from Curse on that. And then the second one as well. We'll see what they can keep it going. Curse has gotten themselves in the position for a few good things. The kills they have under their belt, but 7,000 gold. It kind of puts Curse, and I said it before, back into the position where they were the ones to state, can we do this? Actually, let's not. Can we do this? Actually, we can't. And it's going to start getting quieter and quieter.
One thing to note is that I Will Dominate has went for the Trinity Force on Vi as opposed to a full tank build. And I think that's because they see Sneaky as a priority and they really want him dead. Look for heavy focus with Vi onto Sneaky if they find something. Here's the fight.
It's just like Cloud9 had the Spidey sense. They knew it was coming. A beautiful dash out by Hai, but he's followed by Dominate. They go one for one in quick kills. Dominate's very low, and so is Quas. They're that both hook out of the fight, and a great hook in from Lemonation. They try to pull clear into the damage, and it's going to be Quas gets the stop from Cop. It wouldn't have been a kill for the ace in the hole. That was not good.
Yeah, a straight two for one. Curse wanted to find it, but in that corridor, there was just a mess of tanks for Cloud9. Nobody could get through to Sneaky. Good luck fighting through that. Dominant had to flash away.
Yep.
And now they're desperately trying to get back to base before this Cloud9 push.
And Cloud9's thought going into that seemed to clearly be, if they are in this brush, we're okay with walking into it. They knew they had the power.
They knew they had the peel, more likely.
Right.
Because Lemonation just sat there with the box. Balls just sat there with Shyvana. And it went so easily well. Just take a look at this one more time. Watch just the box, obviously, and the Shyvana just being in. That was like a point-blank Shyvana ult. He just wants to burn out the area more so than do a bunch of damage to them. And Curse had to disperse almost immediately. Curse needs to fight in spread-out areas where they can use their mobility advantage. If they fight clumped like that, they are opting into a bad fight.
Yeah, the jungle corridor is not the best place for them to set up a battleground. We have a lot of the items finished up. They have been finished for a while, but just to recheck, the Infinity Edge and Static Shiv on high. Yeah. He has been wreaking havoc. He's 3, 4, and 0. But like we said, those KDAs are lower because they're the ones diving in, being so aggressive.
High's been getting focused pretty hard in these fights,
that too. Yep.
Put himself in some poor positions, but I think the rest of Cloud9 has been picking him up this game.
Yeah.
It's one of the things Cloud9 is actually kind of known for. Is anyone can have a poor laning phase, but it doesn't mean the team will have a bad game. They're very good about picking up the slack when someone is slacking. And this was just another good rotation. Curse is trying to get control of Baron. Cloud9 pushing mid.
There's our first inhibitor turret, and it comes when Curse really is kind of scrambling to get back into their base. There were all sorts there trying to get out of the jungle. We saw Cloud9 in the bottom have a little trouble with that inhibitor turret, but not this time. They break open the base at 31 minutes, and it's going to look pretty clean from here on out. They can dictate a Baron. They can dictate anything.
Yeah, and that was actually incredibly key. Cloud9 had a Baron and could not siege down an inhibitor turret.
Yeah, that's...
The fact that they just outsmarted Curse to rotate for one is incredibly potent. This Baron fight may be the defining factor in the game. Dominate trying to steal.
Dominate on the other side. Gets boxed in. He can still make his way over the wall. He gets the Vault Breaker into Thresh, actually. Lemonation stops that up. The Baron's going to be alive for a long time. Now, Voivoi low. A lot of Curse health bars are low. And Cloud9 is going to appear from the bushes victorious.
Yeah, they did stop doing the Baron. But they could definitely go back for more. Very confusing looking fight there. As now we have the scatter type of team fight. Curse still has some of the mobility here. This, if they're going to find a situation that's good for them, this would be it for Curse. They're down a man, but they have everything scattered. This is what they want.
Lemonation doing a great job at not giving up. That Dominate is somewhere.
Oh no.
They go on to Dominate. They don't want the chance for a smite out, but how much focus are they going to put onto him? Quaz comes up with a kill onto High. They take down Voivoi right away along with Dominate, and it's going to be Cop and Sneaky. AD carries back and forth, but Balls wants to have a say, and Sneaky stays alive. The double kill for Quaz on the top side. He is going to live. He's getting a little bit of regen from that pat, or from just his statistics.
Just being Renekton.
Being Renekton. It looks like he's going to commit suicide on this one. Croc himself in. It's going to be the kill here for Balls. He actually throws down the Ignite, too, just because.
He had to make sure in that one. But as we could see in that fight, it was very chaotic, and Curse almost came out on top. Take a look at watch how Voivoi can get a lot of burst down onto High once again. And then, really, if Cop had 50 more health, he could have easily turned this around for a double kill. Obviously, Quas was being a monster up top here, but it was really this duel down at the bottom between Balls and Sneaky. We missed it on that fight, but it was very close between Ezreal.
Second Baron of the game going down to Cloud9. Very nice job. 33 minutes in.
Whee!
That's not nice.
Saves him.
Oh well. Saint's going to be good. You just need a beach chair, the umbrella, and a brush. You're good to go. Three backing tips. 14 seconds on the dragon, which is worth quite a bit of gold now. It's reached that maximum level for people to be getting some good cash money out of it.
Yeah, second Baron of the game, very important.
Yeah.
Especially because they've broken open the door to Curse's base. And like we said, as long as Cloud9 stays together, they're in complete control. It feels like it's been a much longer game than 34 minutes.
Yeah.
He's trying to hook something.
He was. They're having fun. They know they're quite in the lead, enjoying themselves, and you got to remember to have fun. I'm sure Curtis is trying to keep that in mind right now. It's been a tough game, and that's where you're going to get out of Cloud9, especially when all those lanes are won. We saw Meteos heavily in the jungle in the early part of the game because of the lane winning of Cloud9. Counter jungling was very big towards the red buff. Dominate was forced to go over and steal Cloud9's red buff as they did the same in the early part. And that's something else we've been mentioning.
Yeah.
The early game invasions are definitely coming back, and they're affecting the game from the first second. I mean, it's the early game.
And it's something that Cloud9 has worked a lot on in the offseason. Back in the 2013 season, they did a lot of just, okay, let's get out of the early game. And then they know they'll be better because they just picked really strong teamfight, really powerful champions. This season, they're doing a little bit more about trying to take early control, force early fights, and really be less of a victim to what the other team wants to do really on in the game, and really write more of the story themselves. It's been very effective for them in some games. There's a bit of growing pains, but now they're the ones trying to take it down the mid lane. Owl Dominate's not there.
Dominate using that Triforce a little bit to take down structures as well in the top lane. Balls is going to go back, I believe, to help him out.
Oh, dear.
See, no, Ball stays into the fight, actually. It looks like we're going to have St. Vicious going down on the turret. That's a big amount of damage coming in. Void Boy Cop and St. Vicious have all fallen to a double kill in the fight, though. And it looks like they're going to be easily able to swap out a few more. Quas is the only one that stays alive onto this fight.
Yeah, that could very well be the game, Rip, because Curse was not back to defend their double Nexus turrets, thinking Cloud9 would be slow to the punch. But Cloud9 is never hesitant.
Slow to the punch indeed. It looks like they want another kill, but it's going to be only Nexus turrets. A 36-minute game here for Cloud9 as they finally take down Quas on Renekton. The Nexus is going to fall, and that's going to be a 10-3 Cloud9.
Yeah, 10-3 on the season. 7-0-8 score for Sneaky's Caitlyn that game. Solid performance from start to finish. We talked about how difficult it is to prepare for Curse sometimes. Picks and bans. There weren't any big surprises from Curse.
No.
Surprisingly, the LeBlanc, the first time LeBlanc has lost in the North American LCS. High went toe-to-toe with that on Yasuo, and the rest of Cloud9 was just supporting him from start to finish. 18 kills to 9, solid victory.
Kind of the story of the day. We had a Ziggs versus Zed and a LeBlanc versus the Yasuo. All those killer and wave clears just bring the AD to the table, and they're able to shut him down so far what we've seen. Seeing a Void Boy, like you said, his first game on LeBlanc. He was focused a little bit. They made sure to give him quite a bit of trouble to make sure that LeBlanc was not a problem.
Yeah, it was close at times, I think, in this game. But Cloud9's general control of the map made it so Curse had to take all of the big risks.
Couldn't roam.
Yeah, they couldn't necessarily roam. Void Boy was kept generally in check.
Yeah.
Team fights were generally controlled by Cloud9, and as long as they weren't making mistakes, then it was on Curse to try and initiate in the difficult scenarios.
When we see Curse doing well, usually it's Dominate and Void Boy really getting the gears going.
Yeah.
Whether Dominate had a great counter jungler or Void Boy just starts getting the lane by himself.
Yeah, this was one of those games where Curse didn't really open up their diversity. Oftentimes we'd see Quas. They've had most success when Quas plays really strange things in the top lane, when he plays Gragas or Jax or Karthus. And then Void Boy plays something really unconventional as well, Vladimir or Akali. Mm-hmm. This game, they decided to kind of play it by the book, and Cloud9 knows how to play against the book.
Yeah.
They have a book of their own.
And maybe it was seen in the scrims, and they're like, well, let them play this or that. Who knows? So many things could have happened, but we'll get to talk to the teams. There's still more action when we come back. High and Sneaky.